Hola querida familia en Cristo y apreciados amigos que nos acompañan por este medio. Quiero darles la bienvenida a un nuevo servicio en línea. Hoy es un día muy especial. Celebramos la resurrección de nuestro Salvador y su victoria sobre la muerte. Así que abran sus oídos y sus corazones para escuchar palabra de Dios. Que Dios le bendiga y una vez más, bienvenido a la Iglesia Nuevo Amanecer en línea.
La luz luz del mundo expone tinieblas, dándonos vida y libertad. Rompe cadenas, su misericordia, gracia y perdón solo en él está. Brillaré el reflejo de su amor. La luz del mundo expone tinieblas, dándonos vida y libertad. Rompe cadenas, su misericordia, gracia y perdón solo en él está. La victoria ganó, ahora luz del mundo soy, sobre un monte una ciudad, brillaré, el reflejo de su amor, la luz del mundo expone tinieblas, dándonos vida y libertad. Rompe cadenas, su misericordia, gracia y perdón sobre él está. Brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz en él. Brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz en él. Brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz en mí. Brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz, brilla tu luz en mí. La luz del mundo expone tinieblas, dándonos vida y libertad. Rompe cadenas, su misericordia, hágase perdón sobre él está. La luz del mundo expone tinieblas, dándonos vida y libertad. Rompe cadenas, su misericordia, hágase perdón sobre él está.
Primera de Pedro, capítulo 1, versículos 3 y 4. Que toda la alabanza sea para Dios, el Padre de nuestro Señor Jesucristo. Es por su gran misericordia que hemos nacido de nuevo, porque Dios levantó a Jesucristo de los muertos. Ahora vivimos con gran expectación y tenemos una herencia que no tiene precio. Así que alégrense de verdad, les espera una alegría inmensa, aunque tienen que soportar muchas pruebas por un tiempo breve.
Porque Él vive, triunfaré mañana.
Porque
sé
que el futuro es suyo,
la vida vale can face tomorrow.
Because he lives.
All fear is gone.
Because I know. Is worth the living just because he lives.
Jesus Christ, my Savior. salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living
hope. Hello, everyone. I just want to remind you all about how you can give your tithes and offerings. But before I do that, I also want to remind you that tithing and giving our offerings is not just an act of obedience, it is also an act of praise and worship. So how can you give during this time where we're not meeting in person? There are actually two ways. You can visit our church website at nachurchky.com, or during the service, there's an option on your website that says give. And if you click on that, you will be taken to where you can give your tithes and offerings. Remember, we're praising and worshiping the Lord together. God bless you. Thank you for your generosity.
Good morning, everybody. God bless you. Thank you for joining us online. It's an honor to have you. If it's your first time with us, I want to say welcome. My name is Aníbal Figueroa. I'm the pastor of Nuevo Amanecer, and it's an honor to have you with us this beautiful morning in which we're celebrating Easter. We're celebrating the resurrection and the victory over death of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. I am excited about today. I'm excited to preach and to teach God's word. So excited, in fact, that I stood up from the table. I put pants on. Hey, If you're working from home, you know you've been working in your pajamas and shorts and everything else. I've been working from home too, right? So, but I'm excited today. I got a table, I got my water, the Bible, and I'm ready. So we are going to jump right in. Today, we're actually going to be in John chapter 11, and we are going to study a pretty familiar portion of scripture in which Jesus, he arrived in a city called Bethany when a friend of his had just died. If you remember the story, his friend's name was Lazarus, and him and his sisters were actually very close friends with Jesus. And what's interesting about this story is that Jesus didn't show up while Lazarus was in the ICU or while Lazarus was maybe like in hospice, just taking his last few breaths. Jesus didn't even show up right after Lazarus had died. As a matter of fact, Jesus showed up 4 days after Lazarus had died. And even though his sister had sent word to tell him, hey, this is how our brother's doing. He's really sick. We really want you to come. Jesus actually didn't even show up to the funeral. So I tell you all this because I want you to understand the tone and the environment in which Jesus was arriving. So the text that we're going to be in today is John chapter 11. And the Bible says, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Praise God for the reading of his word. I believe that this text, I think it can minister and teach and speak to each and every single one of us. And perhaps, I don't know where you are today with everything that's been going on in our city, in our state, in our world, basically. Each and every one of us might be able to maybe identify with some of the characters in this story. For example, I mean, you might identify with Martha. Martha, in the story, it says that when Jesus arrived in Bethany, she actually went out to meet him. And when she went out there, I'm sure that her hand was on her hip because she said, Jesus, if you had been here, our brother wouldn't have died. And perhaps you've had those same type of thoughts, perhaps not just during this time and this pandemic, but just in throughout life. Maybe you've had that thought or that feeling of, man, if God had been there, or if God, if you would have been there, my life or my family or my career, my health, my childhood, my innocence. Whatever it is for you, whatever you've lost, whatever you've suffered, often in those difficult moments, we ask, where is God in this moment? And perhaps you have asked that, you know, if God would have been there, if God would have showed up, if he really, you know, would have done something, then I wouldn't have gone through this. I wouldn't have these scars, these memories. I wouldn't have been hurt that way. And man, today, I know that with everything going on, that's in a lot of people's minds. And perhaps you identify with Martha in this story. Other people, perhaps you identify with Mary, because the scripture tells us that when Jesus got there, Martha went out to see Jesus, but Mary stayed at home. And maybe that's how you feel. Perhaps, you know, you're just overwhelmed or discouraged, you feel sad, or perhaps you're even depressed, and maybe the thoughts in your mind is, man, what's the use? There's no use. What happened is done. It's not like God can change the past or help me go to the past. And maybe perhaps that's the reason why you really don't seek after God, or maybe why your relationship with God might be flat, because there's just what can change now? You're disillusioned, you're sad, you're discouraged, or perhaps even depressed. Maybe you today, you identify with Mary because of everything going on, or perhaps other circumstances in your life, or maybe there's some of you that identify with Lazarus. Now you might say, Lazarus, he's the dead guy in this story. How am I going to identify with Lazarus? But at times, man, we all go through seasons or through events where we think that things are just completely hopeless. Perhaps you just have feelings of, you know, things that you think are completely dead or just completely hopeless, dead, right? I mean, you maybe hopes or plans that you had for the future or relationships or ideas or whatever. And just like Lazarus can't get out of the tomb without a miracle from God, perhaps today, man, you need a miracle. You need a supernatural touch of God to help you, you know, just lift yourself up, because we can't encourage ourselves up from deadness. We need a touch of God. And perhaps today you identify with Lazarus in that you need a miracle from God to help you up from the situation that you are in, you know, your family, your health, your career, your finances, whatever it is. You need a supernatural touch to help you out of the deadness and hopelessness that perhaps you find yourself in. But whatever it is, and however it is that we can identify with different characters in this story, I believe that Jesus can minister to us, and I pray that he will minister to us personally and powerfully, because I believe that whatever it is that we need, we can find it in Jesus. Amen. I believe that we can find it in Jesus. So with that said, as just a brief introduction, I invite you, wherever you are, go ahead and close your eyes. Let's pause for a minute. Let's quiet our minds and quiet our hearts, and let's pray and ask God to speak to us through this study, through his word, this beautiful morning. Amen. Oramos. Father God, I thank you for the honor and the privilege that you give us to gather one more time, to pause, to be intentional, and to study your word. And God, I pray that whatever I share today are not simply my thoughts, my ideas, my words. God, I pray that I can just be an instrument in your hands, so that your people, your church, and anybody under the sound of my voice, so that they can hear your voice today. Meet us in a personal and powerful way, so that we could be changed, transformed, so that we can experience your grace and your goodness. And God, I pray all these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You know, there is there's something really interesting about the number 7. I know it's a random transition, but studying this week, it'll make sense in a little bit. The number 7 is actually, there's something very special about it. And I don't know if you've ever thought about it, but there's 7 continents in the world. There's 7 keys in the musical scale, right? Like do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do. It goes again over and over. And there's 7 colors in the rainbow. There's in our bodies also have a connection to the number 7. It is said that every 7 days we actually we renew a layer of skin. We shed an old one and we get a new one every 7 days. Actually, most of the dust in our homes is our shedded dead skin. So some of us probably need to dust more often, but our whole body actually regenerates every 7 years. It is said that every single cell regenerate. So we're a whole new being every 7 years. Our mind is also connected with the number 7. They say that our working memory has a limit of about 7. What that means is that if I was going to rattle off a bunch of numbers, most of us will be able to attain and remember maybe about 7 of them. Plus or minus 2. Some people like me would probably only remember about 5. Other people could remember 9. That magic number is usually around 7, to the point that that's the reason why our phone numbers have 7 digits. The phone company actually wanted the largest number possible so that they could have, you know, the least amount of area codes. And it's interesting that they tried different numbers, and even just raising our phone numbers to 8 digits, the amount of wrong phone numbers that were dialed completely overwhelmed the system. And they actually determined that 7 was that magic number that we could actually remember. But the number 7 is actually very significant in the Bible as well. The number 7 usually has the meaning behind it of something that is complete, something that is whole, something that is perfect. And from Genesis all the way to Revelation, the number 7 it shows up over and over again. From the 7 days of creation, the 7 laps around Jericho, the 7 times that Naaman had to dip himself in the Jordan River to be cleansed of his leprosy, all the way to Revelation, where 7s are all over the place. You have 7 letters to 7 churches, 7 trumpets, 7 seals, 7 angels, 7 bowls of God's wrath. There's 7s all over the place. But my personal favorite representation of the number 7 in the Bible is actually found all throughout the Gospel of John. And it's the 7 times that Jesus actually said who he was. He actually communicated to us who he was. He said, "I am." And then he told us something about himself. And I love that, because I'm thankful that we don't have to wonder or guess. I wonder what God or what Jesus is like, because Jesus is like, "Hey, I am," right? And John, who was a disciple, who was a follower of Jesus, who was an eyewitness of these things, he actually wrote it all down. And in John 20, verse 31, he actually says, "Hey, I have written these things so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah," right? So if you ever wonder, what is God like? What is Jesus like? In the Gospel of John, I invite you to read it if you never have in its entirety. But Jesus would say, "Hey, I'm like bread," right? "I'm the bread of life." You know how you get hungry sometimes? And some of us get hangry, right? We get angry when we get hungry. Jesus says, I'm like bread. When you eat, you feel better. You feel satisfied. I'm the bread that satisfies. I'm the bread that leads to life. Jesus said, I'm the light of the world. You don't have to go through life stumbling in darkness, wondering what the purpose or the point of everything is, what the meaning of life is. No, Jesus says you don't have to go through life aimlessly and without direction. I am the light of the world. I want to give you direction. I want to give you meaning and purpose. Jesus said, "I'm the good shepherd. I protect and I provide. I lead my sheep, the ones who know my voice. I lead them to still waters." Jesus said, "I am the door." He opens up and pours blessings over our lives. He closes up to protect us from evil. Jesus says, "I'm the door. You can walk through me. You have access to an abundant life." Amen. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the vine." I am the way to God, Jesus said. I am the truth. You can know the truth about yourself, the truth about life, the truth about death. Jesus said, "I am the life, the everlasting life, the abundant life, a life that truly satisfies." Jesus said, "I am the true vine, the true vine, and you are the branches." And just like a branch can't live apart from the trunk, apart from the vine, Jesus says, man, apart from God, you can't reach your full potential. You can't live your full life. And that's why Jesus invites us into an organic, a constant, a growing, and a life-giving relationship with him. Because if we're on this on-again and off-again relationship with Jesus that is constantly being interrupted, then his power can't flow through us like he wants it to flow through us. And today we're going to talk about this powerful declaration that Jesus said, man, "I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life." And this is a perfect description of Jesus for us to pause and to think about and to talk about today in Resurrection Sunday. But before that, before we do that, I think it's important for us to speak about death. We're going to talk about resurrection. We are going to talk about life. But I think that first it's important for us to speak about death, because the truth is that resurrection, death, apart from death, the resurrection doesn't mean anything. Apart from death, the resurrection doesn't mean anything. Which leads me to today's message in a sentence. Today's message in a sentence, again, if you don't hear anything else, I want you to walk away with this thought. And it's that the resurrection is only possible and it's necessary because of death. Is that not the truth? The resurrection is only possible and necessary because of death. And it's necessary because of our death, both physical and spiritual. And the text that we read actually speaks about both of them, right? Jesus said, the one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And I think that all of us can agree, whether you believe in God or not, I think all of us can agree that we're not just a physical body. There's a spiritual essence to us, and I'll prove it to you. I mean, if you were to amputate both of your arms, both of your legs, take out a kidney, a lung, your gallbladder, I mean, that doesn't make you less of who you are. You're still the same person. Because we're not just a physical body. We are a physical body with a spiritual being. I heard it described that we're sort of like an envelope, right? What's really important is inside. The envelope you throw away when it's done with, but what's valuable is what's on the inside. That's what makes you you. And one day when we all pass away, our soul, it is going to come out of our body and it is going to spend an eternity somewhere, either with God or apart from God. And that's why the resurrection, it was possible. It's only possible and necessary because of death. And it was necessary because of our death, but it's only possible because of Jesus' death. Amen. The resurrection is only possible because of Jesus' death. So again, before we speak about resurrection and before we talk about life, I want to share with you this morning three truths about death. Three truths about death. Number one, death is vicious. Death is vicious. I mean, death, especially now that we've been exposed to so many news, and so much turmoil, so much chaos and tragedy around the world, man, more than ever, are we not aware that death is cruel, it's heartless, it's brutal, it's unkind. Death doesn't have mercy, right? It's not like death would say, oh, you're in your early 40s and you still have young children. Oh, you don't have life insurance? Okay, well, I'm going to, you know, because probably your family's going to suffer financially and they probably won't even know how to pay rent. So I'm going to spare you. I'll go to someone else. No, death is perverse. Death is wicked, right? And today more than ever, we know that death has no favors, whether it's young or old, rich or poor. It doesn't matter what education level, what socioeconomic level. It doesn't matter what country it this matter, right? Death is vicious. It is cruel. The second truth about death is that death is violent. Death is violent. And not just in the fact that some people die violent deaths, which unfortunately is true. People die horribly violent deaths, whether it's car accidents or due to abuse or school shootings or machinery that malfunctions or whatever it is. Death is violent, not only because people die violent deaths, but it's also violent on how it feels on the ones that are left behind. Is it not? When somebody that you love dies, I mean, it feels like your heart is completely ripped out and you can't breathe and you're completely overwhelmed. Now, I personally, I've had very few experiences with death. In high school, I had two friends. One of them was a known person that a guy that I knew. He was a senior when I was a junior. And he committed suicide. Corey was his name. Cool guy. We used to play baseball together. But the other guy, he was in my grade. And we used to skateboard together. We used to play volleyball together. We were close friends. And our senior year, he committed suicide. And I remember the whole school just being heartbroken by that. And like I said, I haven't had much experience with death other than these things. You know, all I've lost in my immediate family are my four grandparents, and they were elderly. But my mom, she lost her mom when she was in her 30s. Now, I had my son when I was in my 30s, and man, I need my mom. I'm in my 40s now, and I still need my mom. And I know that, man, it can feel violent. It's brutal and vicious how death can just rip somebody away from our lives. And studying this week, you might have heard that there's 7 stages of grief. There you go, another number 7. When you lose somebody or you go through some type of dramatic loss, you usually go through 7 different stages, like shock and denial and then anger. And then you kind of start bargaining with whatever higher power until you finally reach the bottom and depression. And then you start kind of testing, seeking realistic solutions, and until finally you can reach a point of acceptance. And again, reading articles and studying this week, I found a few charts that show these different stages in almost like a bell curve. It's almost like a big, you know, U this way. And it shows like shock and denial and anger, just like at a downward, going downward until you reach the bottom when you're completely depressed. But then you kind of start getting out of it until you can reach acceptance. And it's all very neatly and organized, right? As if that's the way that we go through our emotions. But I found this picture of what some of those emotions actually feel when we're going through them. Because, man, sometimes it's just something that you see or that you hear or an experience that you have that brings back those thoughts, those memories, those emotions, and those feelings. And then you feel just violently thrown back into some of these stages and some of these things that you thought you had overcome, but no, you're back to confusion and back to anger and back to depression. And the truth of the matter is that it's not clean. It's not a clean curve at all, because death is violent. Death is vicious. And number 3, death is vile. Death, it really is vile. And this is true just biologically, right? The instant that life leaves our body, the instant that our soul leaves this physical shell and steps into eternity, at that instant, our body begins to return to the state to which it was made of, right? The Bible teaches us that God formed us from the dust of the earth. And as soon as life leaves our body, it starts that process of decomposition, whether via cremation, which is quick, or through decomposition while being buried. But when a body is buried, man, and it starts decomposing, the smell, there's a smell to death, right? And it's vile. And it's actually mentioned in the text. We didn't read it, but in verse 39, when Jesus tells the people, hey, move the stone, Martha actually tells Jesus, no, don't do that. Why? Because my brother, he's been there for 4 days and there's going to be a terrible smell. And the truth is that, man, death is vile. It is all these things, but it was never God's plan for his creation to experience this. And we sense it when we lose someone close, someone that we love. I don't care if you believe in God or an afterlife or whatever. When we lose somebody, death feels wrong. And it is. It's perverse. And it's not how it should have been. It was never God's original intent. And one day, God is going to reverse that. We won't experience death anymore one day. But in the meantime, the truth is that death is vicious. Death is violent. And death is vile. Now, I know that this has been a pretty dark Easter message so far. I went Johnny Raincloud pretty quick this morning. But the truth is that, man, good news is not that good unless we get bad news first, right? I mean, if you know that there's a cure for cancer, man, that's amazing, right? But if you right before that found out that you have cancer, how much better news is it that they found a cure for cancer? You know what I'm saying? So we need to know this. We can't just say hooray for Easter. No, we need to immerse ourselves in the story and in a way stand right here in a cemetery because, man, that's where Jesus rose out of. We need to understand that those were the circumstances which Jesus rose back to life. People were crying. People were mourning. They were hurting and confused. They had questions. They had doubts. People were going in and out the different stages of grief at this moment. So again, the resurrection is only possible and necessary because of death. It is necessary because of our death, but it's only possible because of Jesus' death. And in a way, man, a powerful way that we can remember this is that Jesus went into the grave so that we could come out of one. Amen. So that we could have life, so that he could offer us an eternal life. So now that I've kind of brought us all down, right? And speaking about death and how vicious, violent, and vile it is, man, I want to talk a little bit about Jesus' death. I want to tell you three truths about Jesus' death. Number one, Jesus' death was voluntary. Jesus' death was voluntary. Jesus didn't have to die. He chose to die. Amen? You've probably heard it said that it wasn't the nails that held Jesus to the cross, but it was his love for you and for me. Amen. And John 10 verse 18 tells us this, Jesus speaking, he says, no one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it voluntarily, right? And you might ask, well, how did Jesus volunteer for his life? It's not, he was like, hey, I'm right here. I volunteer to die. Well, it wasn't just that Jesus didn't die, didn't fight back during his arrest, his flogging and his execution. But Jesus, he actually provoked the circumstances for which he was arrested and flogged and murdered. See, Lazarus wasn't the first person that Jesus resurrected. He actually resurrected a little girl a few chapters ago. We actually don't know her name. All we know is she was the daughter of a guy named Jairus. And if you remember the story, when Jesus brought her back to life, he actually kicked everybody out of the room, everybody out of the house, and told everybody, actually, she's not dead. She's just sleeping, right? And then brought her back. But in this case, this was completely different, right? Jesus not only was it public, but Jesus, if you remember, Jesus showed up 4 days after Lazarus had already died. And the reason that's significant is because in this time, there was an urban legend that the spirit would actually just kind of hang around the body for about 3 days. And at times, you know, if the person was only a little bit dead, not all the way dead, the spirit could come back into it and the person come back. So for Jesus to come back on the fourth day, it means that Lazarus was completely dead, not mostly dead, but he was completely dead. And people knew it. This was one of the biggest and most public miracles that Jesus did. And the scripture tells us in verse 41 and 43 of John 11, that when they rolled the stone aside, Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I say it aloud for the sake of all these people standing here so that they will believe you sent me. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And if you can imagine the scene, I'm sure people were like, look at this fool talking about Lazarus come out until Lazarus came out, right? Again, this was the biggest and the most public miracle that Jesus did. And he did it knowing that doing it was going to lead him to the cross. And I say that because in verse 53, it says that from that time on, the Jewish leaders began to plot Jesus' death, because now Jesus was just not this teacher, this moral teacher, this prophet guy. No, no, no. Now people are saying this guy brings people back to life, right? And if you remember, right after this was Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. The rumor has, you know, the story has already ran. Hundreds and thousands of people are believed. They're receiving him as king. And that's why the religious leaders, they started thinking, man, they were plotting for his death. So Jesus' death was voluntary, not only because he didn't fight back, but he actually caused, and he actually, you know, he caused the circumstances. He provoked the circumstances for which, and that led towards his arrest and crucifixion. The second thing that we know about Jesus' death is that Jesus' death was vicarious. Jesus' death was vicarious. Vicarious means that you do something for someone else or through someone else. And both of those things are true about the death of Jesus. Because I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but Jesus didn't only die for you. He actually died as if he was you, right? Jesus didn't just die for us. He died a substitutionary death. He took our place. He died as if he was us, right? And 2 Corinthians 5:21 tells us that God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin so that we could be made right with God through Christ. As Jesus died on the cross, he was vicariously dying for us. And God poured the wrath that our sin deserved, he poured it on Jesus. I heard it said this way, and it's so powerful, that God treated Jesus like we deserve to be treated, so that he could treat us like Jesus deserves to be treated, right? And that's the reason why the believer, the follower of Christ, that's why us Christians, man, that's why we're called to a life of joy and a life of hope. Amen. Because when you put your faith in Jesus, when you accept Christ as your personal savior, when God looks at you, he actually sees the righteousness of Christ. And even when we sin, even when we stumble, even when we mess up, or when we don't, you know, we go a few days without reading our Bible, or we've missed church, or we feel like a failure, God looks over us and he says, man, you look like Jesus to me. You look like righteousness to me. And that's not something that we exploit or take advantage of, but instead it's something that impulses us, and it leads us and encourages us to go deeper, to seek more, to serve more, to love him more, to worship him more, because it wasn't something we earned or we did to deserve it. It was freely given by grace, by his love and his mercy. And that's why we're called to a life of joy and hope, because Jesus died voluntarily and vicariously in our behalf. And thirdly, and most importantly, is that Jesus' death was victorious. Amen. Jesus' death was victorious because he didn't stay dead. Amen. That's why we're celebrating today, because on Sunday morning, Jesus got up from the grave and he is alive today and forever. And he offers us that eternal life so that we can have the assurance and the certainty that one day our soul will be in heaven with the Lord until he calls us. And actually, we also will resurrect our physical bodies, and our soul will reunite one day, and we'll have a new, upgraded, reformed, perfect, resurrected version of our body like Jesus has right now, which we will live in forever. And all of that is only possible because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And man, that is the bedstone of Christianity. This is our core, this is our cornerstone and our foundation. To be a Christian is to believe that Jesus died and rose again, because without a resurrection, there is no Christianity, right? Without a resurrection, there is no Christianity. We don't believe that Jesus was simply a good guy or a moral teacher or perhaps a prophet from God. No, I mean, Jesus was completely radical. The things that he taught, unless he backed them up, I mean, he said things like, hey, I'm God, and if you believe in me, even though you die, you're going to live again. I mean, unless you back that up somehow, Jesus is a whack job, right? I mean, he's a complete nutcase. And the truth is that, man, if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then that means that death won, that sin won. If he didn't rise, that means that Jesus doesn't have authority over sin. Therefore, he can't forgive our sins. If Jesus doesn't rise from the dead, it means he doesn't have authority over life and death. Therefore, he can't offer us an everlasting life. If Jesus doesn't rise from the dead, it means he doesn't have authority over evil, over the enemy, right? Over these things. And what that means is that there's no hope. This world full of pain and sickness and death and mourning and suffering, that this is all there is if Jesus didn't rise from the dead. And that's why Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, he says, if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. This is our bedrock. This is our foundation. If you remove the resurrection, there is no Christianity. There is no hope. There is no forgiveness of sins. There is no eternal life. There is no hope for heaven if there is no resurrection. But because Jesus rose from the dead, he actually backed up his claims, amen? He proved that he does have authority over life and death, which means that he can forgive our sins. He can promise an everlasting life. He can give us eternal life. There is hope. There is life after death, and Jesus proved that. And man, I'm excited because this is the message of Christianity. If you read the book of Acts, this was the message that they proclaimed. Let me assure you that if it was only because of Jesus' teachings, the prodigal son and the shepherd that leaves the 99 to find the one, if it was only for his stories and his parables, let me assure you that Christianity wouldn't have made it past the first century. Because Christianity doesn't have the corner on moral teaching. We're not the only ones that teach that we should be kind and generous and humble and loving. No, a lot of people teach that. We don't have them corner on that. But the message of Christianity and what the disciples were preaching when they started this new movement called the church, they said, hey, Jesus, the Son of God, he came and you killed him. And you shouldn't have done that, but it's okay because he came back to life, right? Proving that there is life after death. And because we believe in him, we have life. And if you believe in him, then you will have life. And that's why after just the first two sermons, more than 5,000 people put their faith in Jesus. Because the reason Christianity exists and the church still stands today is because of the resurrection. And man, but not only that is our crown jewel. That is our prize. That is the most important thing about Christianity. But that's not it, because at times we think of our faith or we think of the resurrection as sort of like fire insurance, right? Well, when I die, then I'll be able to go to heaven and enjoy and take advantage of that and everything else. But in the meantime, right? And we treat our faith or we think about the resurrection kind of in those ways. And that was actually the way that Martha was thinking. If you remember when Jesus told her, hey, your brother will rise again, Martha was like, yeah, I know that he'll rise again on the last day. And that's how a lot of people think about heaven. Oh, heaven's just a crutch, right? To excuse all the bad things that happen in this world. Well, yeah, life stinks right now, but at least you're going to heaven, right? But that's not it, right? It's not just one day when I die. And that's why the response that Jesus gave her is so powerful. Because Jesus said, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. I am, in present tense, I am the resurrection and the life. He said, everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die, will never die. And man, this is what the resurrection means, that it's not just something for our eternity. The resurrection is not just something for our eternity. It's for our day-to-day journey. Amen? The resurrection is not just for our eternity, it's for our day-to-day journey. Our relationship with Jesus is not something that's going to impact our lives or that we can enjoy, well, once I die. No, Jesus came to give us life and to give us a life in abundance. Amen. Jesus, resurrection is not something that Jesus does. Resurrection is who he is. Amen. And when we trust in Jesus, when we live our life, when we depend on him, when we rely on him, we actually tap into that resurrection power in our daily lives. And that's what, again, Paul writes us in Romans 8, verse 11. He actually says, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give you life. He will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. It is through the resurrection power that God transforms our lives. Amen. It is through that resurrection power, not one day in the future. No. We're called to walk with him. And it's through the Holy Spirit and the power of the resurrection that God gives us new life and new hope and new strength. Amen. And he brings back to life and brings life into new potential and new hopes and new passions, new purposes. Amen. New dreams. He brings back to life relationships and families and friendships, because as we grow in our relationship with God and humility and love and grace, God just uses that to heal our lives, to restore our past and our pain. God never takes pain for granted. He uses it to mold us and to make us more like Jesus. So again, the resurrection is not something that Jesus does. Resurrection is who he is. And when we live for him, when we live with him, when we rely on him, when we depend on him, when we trust him, God gives us resurrection life. Resurrection is not, it's not something that happened, that just he does. He is in us, and that resurrection power can come in our lives by simply us asking God in prayer to give us new life, to give us new strength, to give us new hopes. Amen. So wherever you are today, and whoever it is that maybe perhaps you identify today, perhaps with Martha, and you have questions, you have doubts, you have things that you're wrestling with, where was God in this moment? I want to say that God, he wanted to show something more powerful at this time, and perhaps he is inviting you into a deeper relationship with him, because, man, he wants to show you who he is. He is the bread of life, the light of the world. He is the good shepherd. Amen. Perhaps you're down and you're discouraged, you're disillusioned and depressed. But I want to tell you that there's resurrection power for you to lift your spirit. Amen. To lift your head. He has purposes for you. He wants to give you an abundant life. There is forgiveness. There is grace. There is love. And there is life in Jesus. And for those of you that perhaps there's areas in your life where there's just this real sense of deadness and hopelessness, there is life in Christ. The resurrection is possible and necessary because of death. And perhaps in this hopeless situation, man, you're in the perfect moment to experience a miracle, because where else can you look up? Where else can you look except look up to the Lord? So with that said, let us pray and let us go ahead and finish today. And then I want to invite you into making a decision for Christ. Oramos. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for, God, for these people that in the middle of their pain, you reveal to them your presence, your power, and your love. Everybody continuing to pray. If you're here today and you've never put your faith in Christ, if you, perhaps you say that you believe in God, but if you're honest, you're not living for God, or perhaps you don't have the certainty or the assurance that when you die, you are going to spend eternity in heaven. Jesus actually came to earth to give us that assurance. He offers us eternal life and forgiveness of sins. And perhaps you may ask, well, what do I have to do? Well, that's the beautiful thing. You don't have to do anything because Jesus already did it all. All you have to do is believe it and receive it. And if you're feeling, if you're feeling drawn in, I would say lean into that, because that's the Holy Spirit of God inviting you not into a religion. He's inviting you into a relationship. So right there where you are, just repeat this simple prayer. This is not a magical prayer. The words don't matter. I'm not even there with you, but God sees your heart. So right there where you are, simply say, Jesus, I believe that you are God. I believe that you died for me. And I believe that your death on the cross was sufficient payment for my sin. Jesus, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner and that my sin separates me from you. I repent of my sin and I received your death as payment for my sin. Jesus, come into my life, be my Savior and my Lord. I believe that you rose again on the third day and that you're alive today. Thank you, Jesus, for dying and for rising for me. Help me to live the rest of my days for you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you repeated that simple prayer, I believe and have faith that God sees your heart and you are now a new creation. You are a child of God. Welcome to the family of God. I encourage you to please tell somebody, share with somebody, write it down right there in the comments. Our church and our community would love to congratulate you. Amen. I want to remind you that right underneath me, there's the box for prayer. If you need prayer for anything, go ahead and write it in and submit it. I'll get a personal email. I would love to serve you in that way. And again, I want to thank everybody for coming today in this beautiful Sunday morning. Amen. God bless you. Have a beautiful day and a tremendous week. And God willing, I will see you next week.